Good job.
Good game. Yeah.
It's all right.
And we're back in our usual spot for another episode of Withness. This is the podcast that accompanies the With God Life, our series where we explore scripture from Genesis all the way through Revelation, and we look at it through the lens of spiritual formation. I'm Rob, one of the pastors here at White Plains.
I'm Jason, one of the other pastors here at White Plains.
And we're glad to have you with us today on this Withness podcast. Today we're talking about the people of God in rebellion. We first started talking about this last week with Isaiah and Jeremiah, and of course Pastor Kelly Lynn preached on that this past Sunday. Yep. And so today we continue in that theme of these wayward, rebellious people and the prophets who speak to them and still speak to us today by looking at the prophets Hosea, Amos, and Joel.
The four-letter prophets.
Hosea has five letters.
It's four. But J-O-S-E.
So we're glad you can join us for this. What's your first take on these guys, these prophets? As well known as Isaiah and Jeremiah.
Yeah, and they're called the minor prophets because they maybe didn't have as much to say. But man, my hot take, and I was thinking about this during my drive in, mm-hmm. You know, these are collected poems, sermons, mm-hmm. and writings. Mm-hmm. Okay, they're collections, they're put together. The timeline could be linear. You know, we talked about last week how it was a roller coaster of ups and downs, of accusations by God, and then words of hope and reconciliation, mm-hmm. and you know, mm-hmm. so it up and down the entire time. But we don't know how linear they are, and the collections. My hot take is this: I mean, we live in an age of communication now, like mm-hmm. no other. I mean, listen, every day we can say that, like no other,
right?
Because every day there's an advance in communication. And to make it brief, sorry, sure. Going on here for a little bit.
You're good.
But how and who heard these words? Because it's not like he had a forum where all of Judah or all of Israel,
right?
Israel to the north, Judah to the south, you know, was it Amos that lived on the border?
We actually I don't think we know exactly when Amos in particular doesn't refer to a lot of the...
Not location. But where was the forum? I mean, you know, he's not like a stand-up where, you know, 5,000 people are coming to hear him say, you know, repent and follow the Lord.
Right.
Right? And mm-hmm. so how did they hear this? Who heard it? You know, was he positioned in the temple? Was he near places of travel and mm-hmm. Were in the marketplace? You know, we suspect that he was where the most people were at the time. Was he speaking in the ears of the temple leaders and the politicians? And so when I think about that, it's like today we study it and it's like it sounds immediate. And it sounds.
I think I get where you're going. We act as if the whole of Israel heard this
all the time,
and yet did not repent and turn back to God.
Right.
But actually, there was no way of broadcasting mm-hmm. this other than just the room that it was in, or maybe writing it down and distributing it.
Right. And they existed kind of, they overlapped in some way as well. It wasn't just like, okay, this is the age of this prophet, now a new prophet comes up. Well, Elijah and Elisha, that's different. But yeah, so.
Yeah, it's interesting because we spent some time a while back in the book of Kings, 1st and 2nd Kings, and we remember during that time we played the game, are you a good king or a bad king? Mm-hmm. You know, and the answer is mostly bad, you know, and then so I think of these things as sort of interlaced. Mm-hmm. That's the way it's been helpful for me to think of it, is whereas Kings is telling sort of the narrative history of what happened, mm-hmm. this king bad, then Assyria comes in, you know, and then the kingdoms are divided, right?
Sure.
And then outside invasions come in, and but here we have like the annotated version of that history. Mm-hmm. And we have the prophets telling us, yeah, not only was the kingdom divided, but it was divided for a reason.
Yeah.
And not only did Assyria come in and kick your tail, but Assyria was allowed to do that mm-hmm. because of your decision to turn away from the God of Israel.
Yeah, and it was
and
the
to embrace other gods. And,
you know, it's consequences of those relationships. You know, if you you lie down with dogs, you're going to get up with fleas. Mm-hmm. Assyria and Egypt both had ulterior motives. You know, the whatever mm-hmm. brief confederacies were formed were to their advantage later yeah. on. When it, you know, how do you learn how to conquer your enemy? Well, by being invited inside their walls, which
right
on a regular basis these kings did. Hey, come see what we got.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Thanks. You know, how tall is that wall? build your ladders this tall. But yeah, so that's, you know, it's a that's the part that, you know, you and I were talking about this earlier when we were, you know, kind of setting up how our conversation would go. And, you know, the ways that the kings operated and who they trusted and how they mm-hmm. How they were like, oh, the Canaanites are doing this.
Yeah. Huh,
that looks cool. And it seems to be mm-hmm. to the favor of the people. The people are seeing whatever results they were seeing from the worship of Baal.
Right.
You know, and so in order for me to stay in
that's
rural,
cool. We're going to adopt
yeah,
that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And so that was, you know, you look at that and you're like, man, you know, didn't God tell you not to do that?
Yeah. And the prophets, you know, these three in particular, Amos, Joel, and Hosea, are tuned in to this. Mm-hmm. And they're hearing directly from God, and they're speaking alternative words of condemnation mm-hmm. and hope.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert, a lot more condemnation than hope.
You know, that is, that's Joel.
Yeah.
Joel is, actually, and I love this because, you know, the whole Jesus thing, you know, Jesus's practice of, you have heard it said,
yeah,
but I tell you that, or in the telling of the parables when, oh, we know how this parable ends. Mm-hmm. Oh, wait a minute. He's got a different ending, you know?
Right.
Joel walks in, is living amongst people who have just been decimated by locusts. Now, mm-hmm. Joel is, it's lyrical in mm-hmm. a way, but it's read as narrative, you know, it's kind of prosaic, I guess, if you're going to look at something. And you look at that and you say, okay, well, here's this story, and all of the people immediately, mm-hmm. after the locusts have gone, run to their homes, run to the warehouses, run to their cupboards and see mm-hmm. what's left. What can we salvage from this? And a horrible analogy would be, you know, the utter devastation many in the Midwest suffer from the tornadoes.
Sure.
You know, you always see the footage of them kind of ambling through this total destruction and rifling through their possessions to see if they can find anything. Joel walks in and says, stop. Mm-hmm. Turn away from whatever salvation you think you may find in a can of tuna in the fridge.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Turn your head to God and call on God to be the God that God's promised to be.
Ah.
Yeah. And yeah. so it rend your garments and tells the priests, you know, stop looking for, there is no more wine. Give up on that.
Right.
You know, and so to
a
me.
A call to earnest repentance.
Right. And that connection right. to Amos and the worship aspect of it. Like,
yeah.
you do not need these things to worship. You have me. You know, these things are, it's a way to augment worship, certainly. But mm-hmm. you priests in the temple, you do not need the wine. There is no bread. Turn to God and offer, you know, make an offering of yourself.
Yep.
And so that's what's beautiful about Joel to me. Joel walks into a situation where it shows, like, it seems like he lacks compassion. But the true compassion is turn to God and call God for the promises God's made. God has promised to be a God of salvation, a God of sustaining grace. Call on God and say, God, show up in the way that you've told us.
Yeah,
show
this
up.
Is the same God, though, that speaks through Amos and says, I despise your festivals.
Mm-hmm.
I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. All right? Hosea says, you have plowed wickedness. You have reaped injustice. You have eaten the fruit of lies. Mm-hmm. I mean, and Joel has just as bad, right? So, asking God to be the God God has promised to be mm-hmm. by turning yourself inward in your own repentance, it strikes me that there's too often we fall into two camps of reading these types of scriptures and this type of genre of literature in the mm-hmm. Bible, right? Because some of this is narrative, but a lot of it is poems and letters and things like that, just like Jeremiah. It's sort of collected works. And the two ways that we kind of fail, I think, is one, to take it as the anger and wrath of God. Like, mm-hmm. I can remember having a conversation with a young person who was espousing a very Calvinistic way of looking at things, and without getting too deep into theology, in his worldview, humanity has total depravity, right? We are bad, mm-hmm. rotten, and God is punishing us for that. Mm-hmm. And God already knows that we're rotten and is going to punish us accordingly. And it's a very cause and effect theology. And I asked him about 9/11, mm-hmm. and I was like, well, do you really think that God caused those planes to fly into those buildings so that, the country would turn back to God somehow? Mm-hmm. And absolutely, he's like, yeah, I'm going to have to go with Amos on that. And starts quoting me chapter and verse out of Amos, I will punish your wicked ways. But, so that's one way, right? I'm sorry, but I think that's, I'm not sure that's a right reading of mm-hmm. those Amos texts. In that, to apply it, that easily to the awful thing, like the hurricanes, when a flood hits New Orleans, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, well, New Orleans, wicked city, wickedness there, they got what they deserved, mm-hmm. Or we even assign that to people, they were saying that about the AIDS epidemic, that's just, I think that's a horrible application of scripture. However, the other extent of that, the other side of that is to say that, oh, well, these guys didn't really understand how God operates because God is a God of love. Mm-hmm. And, God is a God of agape, of unconditional love. And so God would never strike down God's people or suffer them mm-hmm. or cause them to suffer, right?
But it's in Amos that we, and maybe not for the first time, but it's the first time that I noted it. It's in Amos where we find out that God's heart can be broken. And I think, and it's also in Amos where, we have this narrative of a child taking advantage of a father's generosity and leaving. Mm-hmm. The father is given to cast, to damn the child, and then has a moment of reconciliation, a moment of heartbreak, and says, no, I can never turn my back on one of my
own
children.
How could I turn my back on you, Ephraim?
Yeah, and I look at that and I go, listen, this is Jason's take, and I feel like it's an educated one, but I don't want to make it seem flippant. Mm-hmm. But all of these disasters, we can attribute to God's the consequences of turning away from God, right?
Right.
But conquest and domination and from warlike city-states have always happened and will always happen. They're happening today. They have always, wars and rumors of wars, right? Mm-hmm. But to me, the greatest disasters are the ones that happen every day in the lives of families, in the lives of, in our relationships with one another, with how we both see ourselves and how we treat one another. And those broken relationships are disasters that happen every single day, and the accumulation of those. Mm. We're going to have these things that happen, and so a lot of the writers look at these, or the people observing them, and look at these and say, God's doing this to us because we're not following God.
Right.
And the truth is, God's like, yeah, these big things are happening. But, and I mean, Amos, of course, but you're going into church every Sunday,
mm-hmm.
and you're worshiping me.
As if.
Well, here we go. You ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
You're worship. You're having Holy Communion, but you're not starting with the confession.
Right.
You know that I know that's a. I would love to know
that's
how
why
Pastor
he
Kelly
says,
Lee would
I
feel about that.
You know, you're.
Yeah. You know, you're enjoying the bread and the cup.
Mm-hmm.
And man, that's a fancy cup. That's not the cup of a carpenter.
Cup of a carpenter.
Yeah. You're enjoying that, but I've not heard your confession. Yeah. You know, and the confession is vital
mm-hmm.
to our communion with God, being able to say, you know, God, we've not been the people you created us to be. Forgive us, free us for joyful obedience, right?
Right, right. Yeah, so I think that's really good. I think the root of this to me is that there are consequences for our actions when we are not in line with God's will.
Mm-hmm.
God's perfect, unchanging will. What is God's will? It's God's will that none of these little ones should perish. God is not a neutral clockmaker who sits on the sidelines and lets creation spin out of control, right? God is...
Tell him about Yada.
Yada. I'll let you talk about Yada. So when we are out of line with God's will, then, yeah, we're going to suffer the consequences of our own actions. And God doesn't have to really do anything for that to happen because stuff occurs, right?
Yeah, yeah. God's not an official in this game who is keeping score or pointing out.
Oh, no, no. God, you're right. Yeah. God is not an impartial. God is on a side.
Yeah.
And what side is God on? God is on the side of the oppressed and the outcasts and the least of these. And so what happens when we make of ourselves a people who oppress others,
mm-hmm.
who withhold blessings from the least of these, who don't care about the outcast and the least and the lost.
And you know, man,
we are aligned against God when we do that.
And we are, you know, Bishop Connie Shelton, mm-hmm. you know, she, in her mm-hmm. sermon in opening of annual conference, you know, she said, we're not, you know, we don't follow the God of the Democrat. Or the God of the Republicans. We don't follow the God of CNN or the God of Fox, which was weird because if she'd been, but anyway, you know, we don't. These aren't what we are, and we are. We follow the God who is Jesus.
That's right.
And man, that's messing me up, because when I sit down and I go in the pursuit of justice for the least of these,
mm-hmm.
You know, salvation.
Mm-hmm.
The, you know, proclaiming the good news that Christ has come to save all has to be interwoven in the words of justice as well. Why justice? Because of Jesus, right?
Right. But where does it start?
Where does justice start?
Where does justice and being in line with the will of God, where does it start?
Well, my answer is always going to be worship.
Okay.
My answer is always going to be worship, because how we look at our brothers and sisters and how we treat the other is directly influenced by how we worship God. God, if we cannot first forgive our brothers and sisters, how can we be forgiven by
Let me rephrase the question, although I agree with that.
Yeah, yeah.
But if we are to do with the works of our hands,
mm-hmm.
to make a place at the table for everyone, to do justice, to care for the least and the lost and the oppressed, if that is to be the work of our hands and we fail in that, where does that failure and where does that redemption start?
I feel like you are Tim Reeves in my ordination interview, when I sat there blank faced and I couldn't ask you a very same question, and then finally he went, you know, I went, the cross? He was like, yeah!
Putting God at the throne of our heart. Putting Christ on the throne of our heart. Mm-hmm. Wesley had this beautiful vision of the heart as the rudder of our being.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever sits on that throne will guide the whole ship, you know? So that's what the prophets are ultimately calling us to.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, change your actions, but change your heart, and then your actions will change.
I was watching Parks and Rec when April and I were at the wedding weekend up in northern part of the state, and the city manager, who's played by Rob Lowe, and Ron Swanson were in opposition. The city manager said, "You get excellent work from someone by encouraging them and rewarding them with praise and showing the value in them." And Ron said, "No, it's fear, it's fear, pressure, and hunger. Those are the three things.
Those are the motivators.
Yeah, those are the motivators." And I was just laughing to myself because I was like, "Is the writer of this show a Methodist?"
Yeah, so true.
But you know, the idea that we start by saying who's on the throne. I'm glad you helped me with that one, because you know, that was a confirmation thing. I tried to focus on that all the way through, because every day new gods are being fashioned and set up in front of us.
That's ultimately what the problem is. It's not the people's actions that lead to their consequences. It's their hearts. And their hearts, they've forgotten God. God has not forgotten them. In fact, one of the clear themes through all the prophets is the steadfastness of God's love. And in the beginning of Hosea, we get this really kind of weird explanation for this, where God commands the prophet Hosea to marry a prostitute, Gomer, right? And says that, you know, even though it's a little bit unclear whether or not she's unfaithful before the marriage or after the marriage, but she's unfaithful, and like dramatically and explicitly unfaithful.
Yep.
And it's clear that God is saying this as a metaphor for God's relationship with God's people, that even though the people are unfaithful in horrible and explicit ways, God will not forgive them. In fact, one of my life verses is right here.
One of your life verses?
One of my life verses. The Lord said to me again, "Go love a woman who has a lover and is an adulteress." That's not the life verse part. The life verse part is this. "Just as the Lord loves the people of Israel, although they turn to other gods and love raisin cakes." So, if Bowberry biscuits are a weakness for you, there is hope and redemption in the Word of God. The Lord loves the people of Israel, even though they turn to other gods and love the raisin cakes. It took me a little bit to figure out that the raisin cakes were just a sign of the cultures of other civilizations.
Yeah.
But anyway, I like it in a literal way.
The part of Hosea that just, I don't know, man, it just bore into my heart. What was when God commands Hosea to go to all of his wife's lovers and to reconcile their debts.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about a couple of weeks ago about how Isaiah stumbled.
Radical.
Yeah.
Radical faithfulness to show that's to show the character of God.
In Firefly, Malcolm Reynolds is with Yolanda at the time. This episode is Yolanda. And she starts crying because she's finally been exposed, right? And he makes this statement. He goes, "You know, I've seen you naked, but this is the first time I've ever seen you, like, actually laid bare, laid
right.
open, right?"
Right.
And, but that's it. You know, Isaiah was naked for 3 years, but never as exposed as Hosea was here, because to walk into a situation and say, "I know that you've been complicit in sinfulness with my spouse,"
yeah.
"and that these children are, you know, the three children, I know it says, but are very likely to be children of other relationships,"
yeah,
right?
Other men.
And and if the metaphor is God, God's relationship with us as the good husband, right? As the as the faithful husband, that God would pay the debts for the children born out of wedlock as well.
God covers our mistakes, even though we have sinned against God in ways that are profane. And
well, and how about the people, like, you know, the kids, that kid's question, if somebody lives on a deserted island all by themselves, you know, and they never heard anybody talk about Jesus, or they never, and I'm like, well, yeah, you know, God pays the debts of all the children.
That's right.
Right? I mean, and that, you know, not to get into atonement theology too deeply, but, you know, later on, Jesus shows us that, right?
Before we go, I mean, we've got to wrap this up, but all of this points to Christ. We cannot make it on our own. Yeah. We will never make it on our own. We need the cross. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, your professor, person on your ordination board was right. We need the cross. All of this points.
We may be wealthy enough in this world to self-insure our bodies, but there is no wealth we can accumulate on earth that will ever ensure the salvation of our souls. That is only God's work, and it's the only work God ever wants.
That's right.
You know, God's and
it's the prophet's job to convict us of that.
Yeah.
So, three questions for you. All right.
Oh, we're still doing that.
Yep.
Hey.
So, why do you think that we don't spend a lot of time reading in Amos, Hosea, or Joel? We don't.
Locusts, prostitutes, and calling us out on false worship.
What can these books teach us about our own rebellion from God and God's love?
That's always a good question. Yeah.
I mean, we don't have to answer these here, but we would like for you to spend some time on them. What do they teach us about our rebellion today? Jason said early on that these books could be written today, right? And then last question is, how would we react to a prophet like Joel today, individually and as a society? Mm-hmm. You know, I reacted, I must say, pretty poorly to the young person who challenged me because I disagreed with him. Mm-hmm. I kind of trashed his theology when actually he was standing on firmer scriptural ground probably than I was at the time.
You know, man, I had a very wise pastor who told me one day, never knock down someone's theology unless you are willing to be present for however long it takes to build that theology back up.
That's right.
Like, if you're going to knock it down, then you got to stay there and pick the blocks up with them.
Yeah, a better answer, you know, an answer that I would give now, you know, 20 years.
Of course.
20 years later,
and I didn't mean,
right?
I wasn't like,
would be, let's reason together on
sure,
this.
Sure, sure.
You know, like, I see where you're coming from, mm-hmm. but let's see if we can't get to something deeper. Than just the chessboard gods, right?
So
yeah, the clockmaker and the chessboard. Those competing visions of God. Hey,
can I use that as a? So Jeff Henshaw, actually Shelby gave me this. Shelby Henshaw gave me this book.
This we want to pass this on as a resource.
Yeah.
To you, right?
So this is actually a print version of the Bible Project. Okay, there we go. And it's usually down here in the youth room. I'll bring it up into my office. But there's Zechariah. Man, that was pretty fortuitous. Yeah, I can get right here to back up here to pre-Nahum.
The Bible Project is a YouTube channel that we've recommended before. We've even used videos from it. But as we go in depth into these scriptures, we'd invite you we'd invite you to take a look at their project. Because they will go through these books and analyze the major themes. They'll point out key verses, and they'll do it in a way that's very accessible.
What I love about it more than anything, and what I've used actually, and I used this for the Joel sermon that I preached on. Was it Advent? When was it that I preached it? Oh no, it was Ash Wednesday.
Okay.
I actually use this as an outline.
Well, that
to be
was appropriate.
Able, yeah, and yeah, to be able to understand a little bit better the flow, where you know the chapters, and what was contained in them, and to be able to kind of start framing my sermon.
Yes.
But I treasure this. You know, it's I'm sure that Jeff intended it. The Henshaws intended it to be for the ministry, but I put it in places where I know where it's at. Because I don't want it to get messed up.
It's an awesome book.
If you'd like to take a look at it, you know, pop by my office.
But also take a look at the YouTube channel for the Bible Project. We'll put the link there in the video description. And as we talk about some of these, you know, scriptures in particular that you may be less familiar with, you might find them as good, helpful overview.
Yeah.
And we'll continue talking about the people of God in this new pathway. We're moving from rebellion, which of course these prophets are talking about, mm-hmm. into the period of exile. Mm-hmm. And the prophets that speak particularly to that period of exile, like Ezekiel and Daniel and others. And so we'll look forward to continuing our journey this summer with these guys.
Yeah.
So thanks for being here. Hope this has been a fruitful time for you and that you'll continue the discussion either in your family or your small group or just individually. And if you've got questions about it, reach out to us. And of course, we hope we see you on Sunday where we'll be exploring these themes in worship. All right.
Amen.
Thanks for being here.